हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू ऑनलाइन कोर्स ऑफ मैकेनिकल मेजरमेंट एंड मेट्रोलॉजी। माई सेल्फ अभिषेक त्रिवेदी फ्रॉम मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट एट LJ इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी। वी आर डिस्कसिंग द सिस्टम ऑफ लिमिट्स, फिट्स, टॉलरेंस एंड गेजिंग। इन द प्रीवियस और वी कैन से इन द फर्स्ट लेक्चर ऑफ द चैप्टर वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद द टॉपिक टॉलरेंस। वॉट इज द टॉलरेंस, देन वॉट डू यू मीन बाय जोन ऑफ टॉलरेंस, देन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड unilateral, bilateral tolerance, geometric and positional tolerance, and at the end of the lecture I think we have discussed the topic named as how the tolerance zones are directly affect the economic factors of the industry. Today we are going to discuss the topic interchangeability, and then we are starting with the limits and the core concept, or we can say core definition of the limits. So let us start with the first topic of the today's lecture, that is the interchangeability, or we can say principle of interchangeability. Nowadays the term interchangeability is widely used in the mass production concept. A single company, or we can say a single industry, cannot manufacture each and every components. If we are going to discuss the design of the cars, then as you all know that for the designing of the car, or we can say for the simple assembly of the car, you are supposed to require more than, let's say, 500 plus components. This is a very small figure for the single car. It require more than that, but for example, if we are going to discuss a simple example, then we are supposed to require more than 500 parts for a single assembly of the car. Then industry, or any automotive industry, or we can say any automobile company, will not going to manufacture each and every parts, we can say each and every component of the car. Company will design its own body, company will design its own engine, company will design its own suspension system, braking system, then we can say some other secondary systems that company will going to design, but it will not going to design the bearings, it will not going to design the screw, it will not be going to design the nuts, bolt, it is not going to design the tires, we can say the seat covers, the leather packs, then the deck, then the dashboard, and all these particular things. There are a lot of things, there are a lot of different electrical accessories, there are a lot of different wiring system, and all these accessories, all these particular subsystems are not going to be designed by the single automobile company. What they are supposed to do, they are simply accepting those particular components from the market which is locally available, and then they are going to assemble all these parts and they are going to design their own car. Nowadays, as you have heard, or we can say nowadays as you have know that we have the two different categories of the phone. The first one, that is the Android phone, and the second, that is the category of iOS. Nowadays there are only two categories of the phone, the first one Android and the second one iOS. If you have the Android phone, then the charger, or we can say the charging cable, are very much similar for each and every phone, whether your phone is belongs to a simple single company or it is belongs to some another company. I am not going to discuss which company or which particular brand, but if your phone follows a Android portion, or if your phone follows the particular operating system named as Android system, then the charging system is same for all. Yes, nowadays there are different types of chargers, but if we are considering a single case of the phone system, then we can say that the charger, the charging cable, then the SIM ejector, then the different casing system, and all these particular extra accessorial components are same for all the phones, irrespective of particular company or particular manufacturing form of the phone. So this particular principle shows the interchangeability, that you can change the particular component whether it is follow the parent company or not. Suppose you are going to service your fan is available at your home, and you are going to service the particular fan, then once you have buy that particular fan, then it contains some particular bearings, the bearings having the some particular company, but after 5-10 years, if you have to replace those particular bearings, then it is not possible that you are going to purchase the same bearing which is available in your fan. You can purchase the local bearings, and the bearings will directly fit in your phone and it will work properly. So this concept is known as a interchangeability. You can interchange the product, you can interchange the component, you can interchange the parts at the time of assembly, and then it will work properly. The concept of this interchanging the parts is known as a principle of interchangeability, and it is widely useful nowadays. Manufacturing a large number of parts, it is not economical to produce both the mating parts by same operator. Parts to be manufactured within the minimum possible time without compromising the quality is not possible for a single industries. So to manufacture the identical parts, mass production is a very basic idea, and to do so we have to prefer the different companies, or we can say different industries for the different components. The components are manufactured in one or in number of batches by the different person on the different machines at the different location, but they are assembled at the single place, at the same assembly line. This is the concept of the interchangeability. Interchangeability means any one component selected randomly should be assembled with any another arbitrary chosen mating parts, and still it can be assembled properly. Then the concept is known as the interchangeability. This is the basic fundamental of the interchangeability and how it will directly affect on the mass production concept. So as the definition says, if you are going to select a single component which is very random in the nature, and you are arbitrarily choosing a single component, and if you have to make a proper mating, or we can say if you have to make a proper fitting with the another component, then again you are going to your inventory house, then you are going to select a single component which is very much random, which is arbitrarily chosen component, and still both the components will mat properly and will generate a proper fitting, which is the basic requirement of the particular assembly, then it will, I can say that the particular mating components are fulfilling the principle of interchangeability, and the concept is known as the interchangeability concept. I hope you have properly cleared what is the interchangeability. Now the next topic, that is limits. Now what do you mean by limits? First of all, let us understand the limits, and then we are going to discuss the different terms which is technical, and it is directly related to the concept of the limit. As we have discussed the same example, I am repeating the same example. Suppose I have the shaft, I have to manufacture the shaft which is having the dimension 100 mm. Then this particular size of the shaft is known as the basic size, or we can say the nominal size of the shaft. As we have already discussed that we are not supposed to manufacture the shaft having the dimension exactly 100 mm, then we are supposed to provide some sort of tolerance, the zone of the tolerance, that is let's say 0.4 mm. Then I can manufacture the shaft having the dimension let's say 100.2 mm. I can manufacture the shaft having the dimension let's say 99.8 mm. Whatever the size which is above the basic line is known as the upper limit, the maximum possible value at which we are going to accept the shaft is known as the upper limit. Whatever the size which is below the zero line, or we can say which is below the reference line, or we can say whatever the lowest possible value that we are going to accept, those particular value is known as a lower limit. And these two extreme permissible range for the component is known as a limit of the size. It is known as a size limit. So let us understand what do you mean by limit of size. The two extreme permissible size of the component between which the actual size should lies, including the maximum and minimum size of the component, then this is known as a limit of the size. Then the second is nominal size. Nominal size is the size of the component which is referred to as a matter of convenience, is known as a nominal size. Basic size is the size of the part in the relation to which all the limits of the variations are determined. Then zero line, it is the line with respect to which the position of the tolerance zones are shown, is known as a zero line. As in our example, if the value of 100 mm, that is known as a zero line. Then upper side, it is known as the upper limit. Lower side, it is known as the lower limit of the particular component. Then the respective line from which we are going to define the particular tolerance zone then this particular line is known as a zero line. The next one, that is the size of tolerance. The difference between the maximum and minimum limit of the size is known as a size of tolerance. For our example, if the diameter is 100 mm, then I will accept 100.2, I will accept 99.8 mm. Then the size of tolerance is, let's say, the difference between the maximum limit and minimum limit is known as the size of tolerance. Let's say 0.4 mm, that will be the size of tolerance for our simple case. Then the next is a deviation. Deviation is the algebraic difference between the limit of the size and the corresponding basic size is known as a deviation. Suppose 100 mm is our basic requirement. On the upper side, I will define the upper limit of the shaft, that is, let's say, 100.4 mm. On the bottom side, I will define, let's say, 99.6 mm. Then the algebraic difference between the limit of the size and the basic size, it means 100.4 minus 100 mm, the difference is, let's say, 0.4 mm. Then this particular 0.4 mm is known as a deviation. The deviation is above the zero line condition, or we can say it is follows the upper limit, then it is known as a upper deviation. The particular deviation over here, let's say this is the 0.4, here on the bottom side this is, let's say, 0.4 mm, the difference between 100 mm and 99.6 mm. Then if the deviation is below the zero line, or if we can say it is towards the lower limit of the particular component, it is known as a lower deviation. So upper deviation is the algebraic difference between the maximum limit of the size and the corresponding basic size, whereas the lower deviation is the algebraic difference between the minimum limit size and the corresponding basic size. The third one, that is the fundamental deviation. It is the deviation, either upper or the lower deviation, which is nearest to the line of either a hole or the shaft. It fixes the position of the tolerance zone in the relation to the zero line. As we have discussed the example, I will repeat the same example again. Suppose this is 100 mm. On the top side, suppose this is a 104 mm. On the bottom side, let's say 98 mm. So what is the value of upper deviation? Over here, the value of upper deviation is, let's say, 4 mm. What is the value of lower deviation? In this particular case, lower deviation, let's say, 2 mm. So the concept of fundamental deviation is that whichever deviation which is nearest to the zero line, if I will consider this particular as a zero line, then the nearest value is 2 mm. This is the nearest value. Then this is known as the fundamental deviation. In this particular case, lower deviation stands as a fundamental deviation for the given component. So remember these words: whatever the deviation, whichever the deviation which is nearest to the zero line or baseline or the reference line, that particular deviation is known as a fundamental deviation, irrespective of the case of hole or the shaft. Then the last but not the least, that is the allowance. Allowance means the intentional difference between the hole dimension and the shaft dimension for any type of the fit is known as a allowance. What do you mean by hole dimension? What do you mean by shaft dimension? What is the fits? We are going to discuss in the upcoming lectures, in which we are going to discuss the fits and the classification of the fit. We will learn the terms of hole dimension, shaft dimension and all that in the upcoming lecture. Now what time, you have to remember that allowance means whatever the intentional difference you are supposed to provide is known as an allowance. Suppose you are going to design the piston cylinder arrangement, then intentionally you are making your piston which is smaller than your dimension of the cylinder, then whatever the difference has been generated, or we can say whatever the difference has been provided by you, which is intentional difference, then this particular difference is known as a allowance. So guys, I hope you have properly cleared about the terms which are directly affecting the limits. We have discussed what do you mean by limit, then the tolerance zone, then upper lower limit, deviation, upper lower deviation, fundamental deviation and allowances. We are going to end up our lecture over here. from the next lecture we are going to discuss fits, types of fits, and then so on. We have to discuss the so many things in the upcoming lecture. Till then, thank you.